When we think of a song from a cartoon, often we think of the opening theme or the credits theme. After all, we hear them in every episode. It makes sense that they'd be ingrained in our heads. However, sometimes a song we hear only once has the power to stick around for far longer than it should. So today, we'll do our best to get these songs stuck in your head again as we talk about the top 10 best songs from kid shows. Fair warning, music is highly, highly subjective. Everyone just has a different taste, and you absolutely will not agree with this list. And that's fine. I tried to include a little bit of everything, but yeah, these are just pretty much songs that I enjoy. And hey, maybe there is something I forgot. Let me know in the comments below. But whatever, let's get started. I'm Just Your Problem, from Adventure Time. There's no doubt that the breakout character from Adventure Time is Marceline the Vampire Queen. Originally appearing in the episode Evicted, she quickly rose the main character status and worked her way into Finn's friend group. This is further cemented in the episode What Was Missing. In this episode, a door lord appears and steals the character's most prized possessions, locking them behind a door that will not open unless they sing a song. This leads to the gang starting up a band, with Jake on the viola, Marceline on the bass, Princess Bubblegum on the BMO, and Finn beatboxing. Unfortunately, they can't decide on what song to sing, and tensions start to rise, especially between Marceline and Princess Bubblegum, who appear to have a strained past. Marceline begins to sing a song that comes straight from the heart, causing the door to almost open. This song is called I'm Just Your Problem.
La, da, 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 da. I'm gonna bury you in the ground. La, da, 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 da. I'm gonna bury you with my sound. I'm gonna drink the red from your pretty pink face.
Written by Rebecca Sugar and performed by Marceline's own voice actress Olivia Olsen, this song is about Marceline's anger towards Princess Bubblegum and the way she treats her. While many people believe this episode is about friendship, Sugar has gone on record saying that it's actually about the power of telling the truth, which, as seen in the song, seems to be able to open the door. This song also created some controversy, as it seemed to hint at a past romantic relationship between Marceline and Bubblegum. Sugar apparently wrote the song after one of her breakups, further cementing Marceline and Bubblegum's relationship, and said that the song was hard for her to write.
Shouldn't have to justify what I do, and I shouldn't have to prove anything to you.
The Simple Things, from Hey Arnold. The premise of Hey Arnold is immensely simple. It's just about a good-natured, football-headed kid doing his best to help others. Simple in all the right ways. Just like the song we'll be talking about in the episode Mr. Huynh Goes Country. In the show, Mr. Huynh is a Vietnamese immigrant who lives in Arnold's boarding house. He enjoys banana wallpaper and working at the local sandwich shop. He also secretly has the singing voice of country star Randy Travis. Arnold and Gerald are very surprised when they discover Mr. Huynh singing a song that he wrote, titled The Simple Things, and decide that the world needs to hear his amazing voice. The boys become his manager and help him get discovered. People absolutely love him, and him and his only song rise to the top of the charts. The boys become a bit too obsessed with getting Mr. Huynh to the top, and he decides to go out on his own terms by playing one final show and giving up stardom for good.
You can offer me a diamond-plated pearl. You can send me all the riches in the world. You can tempt me with the palaces of kings. I'd give them back in a big old sack and keep the simple things.
The Simple Things was written by Craig Bartlett, Steve Vixkin, Jim Lang, and Joseph Purdy, and was performed by Randy Travis. Four songwriters may seem like a bit much for such a short one-off song, but the lyrics are so charming and wonderfully put together, it makes sense that they needed all the help they could get to get it just right. The song gives off such a warm feeling of, well, the simple things. It invokes a feeling of nostalgia, even if you haven't really experienced anything mentioned in the song. It's a song of passion, and it shows. Sometimes in life, it really is best just to keep the simple things. Naked Mole Rap, from Kim Possible. One very easy way to tell if a show came out in the early 2000s is if it includes a rap number, usually with a character wearing some sort of backwards visor or parachute pants. You know, stuff that was cool in the 90s that networks were just now catching up on. Kim Possible is one of those shows that committed this cardinal sin in the aptly named episode Rappin' Draken. In this episode, the evil Draken has built an invisible lair right over the ocean. After Kim and Ron defeat him and destroy the lair, Draken goes back to brainstorming new evil plans. He eventually comes up with a brainwashing shampoo, but nobody buys it. So he does the only logical thing to try and promote it. He raps live on television. Kim enters the same show, an American Idol parody called American Star Maker, in an effort to stop the villain. However, in the end, Ron is the one who wins the contest, having his own rap broadcasted across the entire world, giving Kim enough time to stop Draken's evil plans.
What is that? That freaky thing! What's that spot? What's the name of that? Come on, y'all! Let the girlies sing! What's the name of that? Uh-huh! What is that? That freaky thing! What's that spot? What's the name of that? Hey, wait! I can't hear the girl sing! Listen to
the naked mole rap! The rap itself, titled Naked Mole Rap, is actually so bad it's good. Of course, it's meant to be a joke, but it's actually pretty charming. It tells the story of how Ron met Rufus, his pet naked mole rat. His father is actually allergic to every type of fur, so he searched for an animal with no fur. And voila, naked mole rat. The song hits every single mark, having the cute mascot pretending to be hard and edgy in a rap song, and Ron doing the famous rap squat popularized by Jay-Z in 1989. It's dumb, but is that really a bad thing? If the song really speaks to you, you can get it on the Disney Classics album and listen to it anywhere you want. The future is now. The Birds of Prey from Batman the Brave and the Bold. Batman the Brave and the Bold is one of the more humorous and lighthearted takes on the Caped Crusader, taking many cues from the 60s series instead of the darker entries such as the animated series or the Dark Knight. Each episode has Batman teaming up with another hero from the DC universe in order to take down a villain or something. It's notable for including many underrated and forgotten characters, such as Batmite. While the series was unfortunately cancelled, in order to create a more serious Batman show, Beware the Batman, the show left us with some amazing and hilarious memories, including the anthem of sexual innuendos, The Birds of Prey.
Good evening, all you gentlemen, mobsters, creeps, and crooks. Men in tights come after you, and still you're off the hook. For those who scare and terrorize, it's the dawn of a brand new day. You scum can simply call us the one and only Birds of Prey.
In the episode The Mask of Matches Malone, Batman gets amnesia and believes himself to be an underworld gangster. It's up to the Birds of Prey to bring him back to his senses, a group that consists of Black Canary, Catwoman, and the Huntress. The group sneaks into the gangster Batman's nightclub and sing a song to try to bring him back to his senses. The crowd loves it, but it's not a hit with Batman, unfortunately, even though the song was pretty much telling him how he's the sex king of the Justice League. The lyrics go into detail about how each league member has their own sexual problems, specifically lines about Aquaman's small dick and the Flash's premature ejaculation. Things get especially risque whenever they begin speaking about Batman, whose batarang is a good bang, and that his utility belt can make a girl's heart melt.
Aquaman's always courageous, his little fish less outrageous. Plastic Man can expand, becomes funny in our hands.
This song drew quite a bit of controversy from parents due to its sexual nature. And well, yeah, it's pretty much dripping with it. It's not hard to imagine the writers having a ton of fun with this, and it is pretty entertaining. Maybe just not the best thing to put into a kid's show.
No one does it better. No one does it better than the Birds of Prey. Birds of Prey. Meow.
Stronger Than You, Steven Universe.
This is Garnet, back together. And I'm never going down at the hands of the likes of you, because I'm so much better. And every part of me is saying go get her. The two of us ain't gonna follow your rules. Come at me without any of your fancy tools. Let's go, just me and you. Let's go, just one on two.
Steven Universe is known for many things, including its progressiveness in the portrayal of LGBTQ characters and long, long hiatuses. It's also known for its use of simple and charming songs, written by showrunner Rebecca Sugar. The music ranges from many different styles, from Steven's simple ukulele riffs to Pearl's elegant ballads. However, up until the finale of season 1, we hadn't really had a solo song for Garnet yet. The finale, Jailbreak, gives us just that. The episode picks up immediately after the previous, where Garnet was defeated by Jasper. Steven wakes up on a strange spaceship and finds a gem prisoner named Ruby, who is searching for another gem named Sapphire. Steven helps the two reunite, where it is revealed that together, they fuse into Garnet. Having newfound confidence in her strength, Garnet takes on Jasper one-on-two, singing the song Stronger Than You.
Go ahead and try and hit me if you're able. Can't you see that my relationship is stable? I can see you hate the way we intermingle, but I think you're just mad cause you're single. And you're not gonna stop what we made together. We are gonna stay like this forever. If you break us apart, we'll just come back newer, and we'll always be twice the gem that you are.
The song is in direct reference to the strength of Ruby and Sapphire's romantic relationship, and how their fury and patience respectively makes their love undefeatable. During the song, Garnet's visor even changes color depending on who she is representing at the moment. And according to one of the show's composers, Steven Surashu Velama, they made the song to emphasize the euphoria of Garnet being reformed, and to capture the feeling of, there's no way she could lose. The song has become incredibly popular since its debut, thanks to Estella's wonderful performance, and has resulted in hundreds of covers and fan parodies. There was a bit of controversy regarding the song in France, though. The song was initially mistranslated, and it was focused on Ruby and Sapphire's relationship as a platonic friendship instead of a romantic one. Fans were outraged, assuming it was homophobia, but actually it turned out to just be a mistranslation error. The song was redubbed to have its original meaning represented. Gary Come Home, from SpongeBob. Whether or not SpongeBob had quality episodes after the release of the 2004 movie depends on who you ask. It's a highly divisive subject, but that's to be expected with any long-running series. The season 4 episode Have You Seen the Snail is no different, receiving mixed reviews from critics but generally well-received by its target audience. The episode has SpongeBob received a paddle ball in the mail and gets consumed by it, leading him to neglect Gary for 10 days. Gary runs away from home to find a new owner, and eventually meets a kind old lady who takes him in and feeds him. Meanwhile, SpongeBob realizes that Gary has run away and starts to put out flyers in search for him. While he does this, we are treated to one of the catchiest but saddest songs in the entire series. Gary, Come Home.
Gary, now I know I was wrong. I messed up and now you're gone.
The song was written by Kazuka Yayoki and was performed by Tony Award-winning singer-songwriter Stu. No wonder it's so catchy. Throughout the song, we see SpongeBob desperately trying to find his beloved snail, only for him to just miss him. There's one shot of SpongeBob sitting alone in his room with huge teary eyes, and it's just heart-wrenching. Luckily, SpongeBob and Gary are reunited, after Gary discovers that the old lady actually wanted to eat him. Even though they are reunited, just hearing this song still makes you so desperate for them to find each other again.
More than a pet, you're my best friend. Too cool to forget. Come back, cause we are family. And forgive me for making you wanna roam.
Love Makes the World Go Round, from the Powerpuff Girls. At a glance, the Powerpuff Girls looks like a generic cutesy show. The genius comes from the subversion of the first glance, that such cutesy characters can be so badass, and still be home in time for bed. In another subversion, however, the girls must use that very cuteness in order to save the world, in the episode Mime for a Change, where they sing a song in order to bring back color to Townsville. The episode begins with a happy-go-lucky Rainbow the Clown entertaining at a birthday party, when suddenly a bleach truck crashes and completely covers him. All the color is sucked from him, along with his good spirits, turning him into the evil Mr. Mime. And no, not the Pokemon. Using his monochrome powers, he sucks the life out of all the citizens of Townsville, leaving them all as joyless husks. The girls attempt to fight him, but the color is sucked away from Blossom and Buttercup, and Bubbles does everything she can, including trying to color her sisters with crayons, but it's no use. She nearly gives up, before she gets one last idea. Bubbles whips out a drum set and hands Buttercup and Blossom a bass and guitar respectively. As she begins to play the drums, the color returns to her sisters, and the three of them play their song in unison, called Love Makes the World Go Round. The song speaks of all the wonderful things in life worth being happy about, such as puppies, kittens, and picking dandelions. The song also works on the citizens, as color returns to the town, but Mr. Mime angrily runs towards the stage to stop him. However, Blossom hits him with a sick guitar riff, turning him back into Rainbow the Clown. Jesus fucking Christ! After the song, Rainbow goes to thank the girls, who proceed to beat the shit out of him and throw him in jail. Classic subversion. Nevertheless, the song is cute and heartwarming, as well as pretty damn catchy.
You can't hurt me with the things that you do. I'll pick up dandelions and
Happy Evil Love Song from Phineas and Ferb. Phineas and Ferb is what you call a show of tradition. Every episode has familiar elements and jokes, such as the "aren't you too young" quote, or the "I know what we're gonna do today" quote, and the "hey, where's Perry" segue. However, the most difficult tradition had to have been the original song included in every episode, sometimes even including multiple songs. Of course, this was completely doable, thanks to the songs being in the hands of the incredibly talented showrunners Jeff Swampy Marsh and Dan Povenmire. The two described their work on these songs as their jab at immortality, and even went on to receive 2 Emmy nominations for the songs featured in the show. So a song must be pretty notable in the show for it to make the list, right? Well, the season 2 episode Chez Platypus gives us that song. The episode features Phineas and Ferb opening up a new restaurant, which quickly becomes the hottest place in town. Candace finally gets to go on a date with Jeremy at the restaurant, while at the same time, Dr. Doofenshmirtz finds a new evil girlfriend through an online dating app.
It's the age-old story, how an evil boy meets an evil girl. We got a love strong enough to rule the whole wide world. We both maniacally laugh at all the same stuff. I found my other half, yes. I've got an evil love.
Throughout their date, the two of them sing a song called Happy Evil Love Song, accompanied by a montage. They sing about their newfound happiness in life and all the despicable evil acts they'll share together in the future. It's silly, but it's a pretty sweet song. Unfortunately, before he met his new girlfriend, Doofenshmirtz created a device called the D-Lovinator Satellites in order to ruin all the happy couple's relationships throughout the tri-state area. Some events throughout the episode caused Perry to smash the remote for the D-Lovinator, causing it to fall out of the sky and land right behind Doofenshmirtz and his girlfriend, right as she's about to confess her love to him. It zaps her. And now she feels nothing for him. I guess he had that one coming. My best friend, Plank, from Ed, Edd and Eddy. Our next entry is interesting, in that it doesn't actually come from an episode of any show, but is rather an official commercial bumper inspired by Ed, Edd and Eddy. Anybody who has watched the show should know Johnny's underlying love for his best friend, Plank. Well, that love is taken up to 11 in the song My Best Friend Plank. The song is very moody and somber, featuring an unknown voice singing about, well, his best friend Plank. The voice doesn't belong to Johnny, but it would still make sense that it was from his point of view. The song goes into deeper parts about their friendship, such as seeing Plank swell up in the rain, but being unable to see his pain, perhaps referencing his eternal smile. Maybe Plank is unable to show pain, always wearing that false smile. I suppose we'll never know. The music video was made by Swedish animation company Film Technarna and superimposes the piece of wood over several real-world events, such as the death of Julius Caesar, Woodstock, the French Revolution, the Trojan Wars, and so on.
And your hammer nailed you, pal. Al Gore's wife's name is Tipper. I knew we'd be best friends for life when I saved you from that chipper.
There's a strange line included about Al Gore's wife Tipper, although the line is a little inaccurate since the two had already split up by the time this song was released. Regardless, the song is nice, slow, and moody, and because of that film grain effect, it evokes yet again another feeling of nostalgia. I don't know, I just like it.
My best friend Plank. My best friend Plank. My best friend Plank. You're my best friend Plank.
Good night, Bert. Boy, look at that moon. Isn't that pretty? Did you ever think you might like to visit the moon? Well, I did.
I Don't Want to Live on the Moon, from Sesame Street. Sesame Street is absolutely filled to the brim with amazingly catchy songs. And how could it not be? With the show nearing its 50th anniversary, it has delivered hit after hit, such as Rubber Ducky.
Rubber Ducky, I'm awfully fond of you.
Mana Mana. And the poetic Being Green.
It's not that easy being green. having to spend each day the color of the leaves.
But today, we'll be giving the spotlight to Ernie with his song, I Don't Want to Live on the Moon. First airing in 1978, the skit begins with Bert and Ernie settling in for a good night's sleep. Before going to bed, Ernie looks up at the moon and asks the viewer, "Have you ever wanted to visit the moon?" He doesn't give you much time to answer before he states that he once did. He begins to sing about how he'd like to visit the moon, but not live there. We see Ernie resting upon the crescent moon, looking down upon the earth, and then swimming in the ocean. This was one of those rare instances back then where you were able to get a look at the puppet's entire body, something we see a bit more often nowadays. Ernie sings about all the amazing places he'd love to see and visit, but again, not live there. All those amazing places just aren't worth it if you can't share with the people you love.
There's so many strange places I'd like to be, but none of them permanently.
So instead, he'd rather fall asleep in his own bed next to his friend. Let's just hope that Bert didn't get too annoyed with Ernie singing while he was trying to sleep. This song became super popular. It was even turned into a children's book. Almost 40 years later, Ernie still hasn't lived on the moon. He's too busy sharing moments with the people he loves.
'Cause I don't want to live on the moon. No, I don't want to live on the moon.